Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear beautiful people, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. We are those that the world has been created for, to take full advantage of this world. Our predecessors that have made great differences in the life of mankind grasped this meaning fully. Did you know that the first country in the world that made hospitals was Egypt? And this was about 1300 years ago. And it started like that, 1300. Europe didn't know something called hospital. In Egypt, this was like if someone falls sick, they would send an ambulance, a cart with horses to pick the sick person from home. They would take him to this, not the full hospital, but to a clinic. In that clinic, he gets assessed as to what kind of disease or sickness he is prone to. Once they figure out, for example, someone has got like a kidney problem, once the doctors find out what he is ailing from, they would direct him to the right department. The nurses, the male nurses or female nurses, take the gentleman to that place. Before getting into his ward, they would first strip him off of his clothes and give him hospital clothes, and take his own clothes for washing up, desanitization, and cleaning them with all his belongings, put them in a small safe, and put them there. I'm talking here, it was 1300 years ago. I'm not talking about England today. I'm talking about 1300 years ago. And then they take him to this department where they're going to take care of his kidneys. The guy stays there. His nourishment is taken care of. The salat is there. There were scholars at the hand, like for questions. There were people that would tell tafsir, recitation of the Quran. So the person gets in a hospital, gets taken care fully. Once the person recovers, and before taking him home, they would first make sure, double sure that he is all right. They would dress him up in his own clothing, send him home in the cart or in an ambulance with a money to go last him for a month or two, depending on what the doctor says. For example, if the doctor says, you go home and you rest for 2 months, then they pay him 2 months in advance of his money. For the medication, the Muslims had invented something beautiful. And these are the organic plants. On the back of the hospital, they would have plants and people would invest. You would donate your sadaqah and you'd go, I want to plant this number of trees or number of this. And those things where they had laboratory at the back of the hospital and they were making up medication for the people. So as you can see, Europe used to send the people, the rich people, to come to the world of Muslims to cure their diseases. Yes, we had like very advanced doctors, the eye cataract. Today in the West, the way we did it 1300 years ago, they still do it the same way today. Why am I telling you this? It's because the Muslims looked at what Allah gave them in presence, in right in front of them, and they used it to the advantage of humanity. And they got a great deal until today, 1300 years later, the legacy lives on. We are proud today with what our predecessors have done. I have nothing really to show the world today of what the contemporary people of today have made to the world. Only if this one carries a knife and goes to the underground and threatens people, and the other one kills, and the other one drives the truck and kills innocents. And some Muslims here that are living in a small box, look at the universality of how Muslims were back in time. What it is, my brothers and my sisters, that I can do that will start making a difference in this world. We Muslims, we always look at how we can do big so that we can affect big. But big is made of so many little tiny things. When we overlook the tiny things, we miss big deal on big things. In my pep talk today, you will see there is a pink plate with some breadcrumbs on it. Probably you wonder what the heck it is going on here. Well, every morning when I have my breakfast, depending on what I am having, I always have this intention beforehand. So I put my plate and do my bread and my honey with my milk. And then I said to myself, when these crumbs fall on the plate, so that I don't dirty the table, I don't do that for that. That is a wasted intention. If I put the plate so that I don't dirty the table, that is a wasted intention. I'll tell you later on why I do that. And then when I finish with my breakfast, and then I look at the plate and I have two options. One, wash the plate and let the bread, the crumbs go down the drain, or do something more interesting. The more interesting bit is I always think to myself, now that I have finished eating, I cannot make sense of these crumbs. However, to a world of creatures out of my window, they can make very good sense of these crumbs. As a matter of fact, this will be their daily rizq. I open my window and throw the crumbs in the garden. And I trust Allah that that is a driven rizq to a creature somewhere, somewhere that I am not aware of, but who is gonna take full advantage of what I have put through my window. Why I don't put my plate on the table to not dirty the table, and as I said, that is a wasted intention, because that's it, it's a wasted intention. However, as soon as I carry the plate in my hand, my intention is to collect the crumbs so that I do my act of sadaqah today and distribute them outside my window so that I benefit the world. How someone can say, hang on, putting crumbs out of your window, you're benefiting the world? I say, yeah, I am. How? Pretty simple. Those little animals that are there lurking in the darkness, lurking on the bushes that neither you nor I know of, each one of them has got a function. That function is to serve mankind. No matter how thin you slice it, it all ends up because Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said it in the Quran that Allah has sakhara lana ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. Allah has made at our service everything that is in the heaven and in the earth to serve you, my brother and my sister. So my crumb go to a small tiny animal. Now if I study that animal, I find out that that animal does something that is important to the ecosystem or into the prevention of disease. Or that little animal does something that helps another animal fulfill his thing. And when I follow that chain, inherently, it will come back to me. I will benefit out of it. So the crumbs on my plate were not just something out of that. It's just I sometimes, or you, miss the opportunity to think, I can't make sense of this. What else or who else can make sense of it? And then I share it with those that share planet Earth with me. And then suddenly it's a win-win situation. You, my brother, I'm a sister. You have little kids every single day. You teach them how to share with their brothers and sisters. The firstborn, you don't think much about sharing because he's got nobody else as a competitor. But as soon as number two comes in, suddenly the idea of sharing comes in. Yet, we do something really, really peculiar, really funny. We actually teach them how to share, and we personally don't share. When was the last time, out of the blue, you shared something with someone? Nobody does that anymore. It's me. We're taking a concept of the day of Qiyamah, and we are applying it on earth today. Wrong. Very wrong. When was the last time you bought a gift and you surprised a brother or a sister just out of the blue? When was the last time you got that done to you? Someone, I have this and I commend a very good brother, mashallah, Omar. One day he came to me and he presented me with a beautiful bottle of perfume. And he gave it to me and go, what's this? And he goes, it's a gift for you. That touched me greatly. Because I thought there was nobody else doing this thing. And suddenly he gives me that. And I was touched. Alhamdulillah, I do this with people. I always, alhamdulillah, bear in mind people and I know how people are and I do this and I do that. But I don't see it often done to me and I don't see it more often done onto people. What has happened to sharing? In our quest in pleasing Allah, and may Allah forgive our scholars today, kept on what? On Tawheed, Tawheed, Tawheed. Even today, they always worked on the vertical relationship between us and Allah, how to have the best Tawheed. But they overlooked something greatly that affects humans more than teaching only. And that is preaching Islam horizontally, how to deal with the world around us. That our scholars failed big deal on it. So here we have people that now they say we are Salafi in the thinking, but they have nothing to do with the Salaf when it comes to actions. So much so that the Salafi themselves, when you go to pray with them or when they meet them, and I have experienced this for years, they don't even say Salamu Alaikum because they have these microscopic eyes and they look at you, how long is your beard? And then they look at your ankles, how high are your pants? And then they look at you, how do you dress? Do you wear blue jeans or do you wear qamis all the time? Are you unemployed living on benefit or do you work? And they have this very binocular judgmental eyes. Once they classify you, once they stereotype you, you are burnt. I have many of them passed, and I was living in Egypt. And they pass is just because we don't have the beard long and you see them all in group and they are on everyone. The other day, I was with somebody on YouTube and he was talking and I was telling him about how people today follow their haircut based on football players, those soccer players, not on the Sunnah. And some of them are even there on YouTube with hundreds of thousands of followers and they put themselves, my name is Dawah Man and I don't know what the other one, Ali Dawah or something like that, these names. And I looked at the haircut and it's haram and where they talk and it's when they talk, they dance like they're talking rap and I look at them and I go, okay. The other day, one day, one of them brought this beautiful, gorgeous girl and I was looking at her and I go, okay. And he says, well, you guys, you know, I don't want to keep things hidden from you. This is not my girlfriend, but we have the intention of getting married. And she is with him in a room with, and I said to myself, hang on. The message that these people are sending to the world out there, to the Muslims, it is okay to have a girlfriend with the intention of marriage and to be with her in a room. And suddenly Islam gets lost in all these fashion statements that people make. And then, that is not a surprise, then one day these two friends, one of them stands up and he says, I warn you against the other gentleman. And I said to somebody, watch out, he's going to warn about a couple issues. And Ashraf, I think he was with me. And subhanAllah, whatever I said, the other one warned the world against this person because I have seen this LP record played 30 years ago. When someone claiming to be the Salafi on their own conditions, when they go on a tangent and they start running the world according to their own vision. We don't have sharing with us Muslims. We don't have it. There is no way to lie to the world. We don't have it. We have one. We are missing the boat greatly in thinking that the Islam is only Tawheed. Not at all. In Muwatta al-Imam Malik, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. And this hadith is authentic. In the translation of the sole purpose for which I was sent, إِنَّمَا, it's an emphasis on the purpose of the messengership of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is to complement the best of behaviors. What does Tawheed do when instead of teaching me kindly and hold my hand with empathy, you are mad at me for me not growing my beard? How many people have quit going to the masjid? How many people, I see people in the street, she's wearing a niqab, but she walks and she looks down on the world with great despise. Well, my sister, your niqab is getting you into hellfire because it's about attitude. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, and this is in Riyadh al-Salihin, an authentic hadith as well from Bukhari and Muslim and the Sunan. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَا سُوَارِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ. Allah does not look at your body nor at the way you dress or the way you appear. Allah looks in your heart. You might have the longest beard, but your heart's beard is shaved. You might wear the qamis all the time and living on benefit and having 3-4 wives and they get the benefit and you live on them. But in Allah's sake, you are walking naked. My brothers, the element of sharing. We are here to share this earth with whoever Allah has created. We're not here to live individual, just worshiping Allah is one, and then as a parrot, just say what has been said without giving it a substance. So my brothers and my sisters, my question today to you is, please, 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 make sure and ensure that whatever you have before you give it, make sure that someone else's makes sense of it. Enough, enough, enough of just thinking of Islam, Allah is one, this is an end of it. Ya Allah, this is not the Islam that was came to be. We work very hard on our tawheed with Allah and we treat mankind as Allah wants us. And we have the best example in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Share, share, share. Make gifts to the people you love. And those who you don't love, start making gifts to them and they will love you. And you will find, I'm sick and tired of going to masjid where there are 1,000 individuals, not even a small team. The imam is singing a song, Allah knows where he's talking about. And the group are thinking about that. Many times people get nothing out of it, nothing out of it. The khutbah of Jummah, if you ask me what he spoke about last week, I don't remember. Don't remember, and we are only Tuesday today. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Share, share, share. 078-7640-8735 is where my number is. If you want to join my group, please do. Do send these pep talks to people. Let them come to Islam as Allah wants it. We want an Islam vertical with us and Allah. And we want an Islam horizontal 360 degrees. That is only when we start really becoming the Muslims we are supposed to be. I love you all and have a wonderful day, my brothers and my sisters. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa.